If you have seen the other episodes in this series, you will know that my goal is to analyze and understand how artists come across and make us feel something. To accomplish this goal, I look at all the little facets of being an artist and how they come together to form an image in the mind of our listeners. And so in the past, we've looked at things like melody, harmony, flow, production, music videos, lighting, design, makeup, clothing, and so forth. But as you will see, when you do that with Sia, things look a little different than with other artists we've talked about. So this time, let's lay out all the facts first and then start connecting them. Contrary to most pop artists out there, Sia writes all of her own songs. In fact, before she got famous herself, she already had a track record of hits like Pretty Hurts, Perfume, Diamonds, and Let Me Love You. These songs already kind of tell you what Sia's good at: writing ballads, and more specifically, sad ballads. In this video, I want to focus mostly on Sia's last three albums because I believe that's the albums most would associate with her. So forgive me for leaving out the five other albums Sia released before she got famous. Here we go. This is how Sia writes her songs. Most of them, according to her own statements, in about 40 minutes. In other words, her process is very quick, intuitive. And so it's no surprise that a lot of her songs share common traits. For example, chords. Listen to this. Another trait a lot of Sia's songs share is tempo. If I asked you to clap or tap your fingers at a comfortable speed, chances are you'll end up at a tempo of about 120 BPM. This seems to be the most natural tempo for an adult, which is why it's the default in almost all DAWs. It is no coincidence that a study from 2011 shows that most hit songs since the 40s hovered between 117 and 122 BPM. Well, for Sia, this couldn't be any further from the truth. Looking at A Thousand Forms of Fear, 11 out of 13 tracks play below 100 BPM, with an average of 86 BPM. So this is definitely on the slow side. What's the effect this has on us? In the 30s, psychologist Kate Hefner-Mueller found that tempo influences emotion more than anything else. Slow music generally makes us feel sad. There's likely a correlation between that and the fact that our heart rate slows as we get older, but I'm no doctor, so that's just me guessing. What is certain is that Sia speaks to an older audience. She herself is older than most of her pop comrades, and her voice certainly makes her sound like she's been through a lot. On top of that, her music videos are artistic, decidedly not fashionable. So let's look at those. It's hard to look at Chandelier and not feel sad by the end of it. But why is that? Let's leave Maddie Ziegler out of the picture for just a second. What do you see? Dark colors, cold lighting, a rundown house, creepy pictures covering the walls, this religious text which has a desperate undertone? The picture is clear. We'd rather be somewhere else. Whoever lives here is probably not in the best of spirits. In interviews, Sia has stated over and over again that she loves watching trashy reality TV, and that she gets a lot of her lyric ideas from those shows.
I just lift these concepts off like crap television. And then, like, it's so fun, and I apply them to music.
For example, this.
I come from the bottom, you know, from Bridgeport, Connecticut, in the housing projects. My father wasn't in the picture, and then he passed away, so I felt alone, but I'm still breathing, and I'm fighting.
Inspired this. C.S. Fable for reality TV also led her to working with Maddie Ziegler, whom she discovered on Dance Moms. And this is what this video feels like as well, like a reality TV show. We're getting a peek into the life of this girl. In a way, we get to be a fly on the wall. There's almost no cuts in the video, which helps us become one with the camera. And we keep close to the ground because we're only observing. We don't want to be seen. Notice also that the video ends with Maddie giving a bow straight to us. Thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed my misery. We feel almost guilty, like we're intruding. Why aren't we helping this poor little girl? And so, unlike all of the other music videos we've looked at so far, we are assigned a role, that of the voyeur, the audience, everything that's wrong with the world. And that's why we feel bad. In interviews, Sia turns her back to the camera. When she performs her songs live on Ellen and the Graham Norton Show, she does so turning away, looking straight into the wall. According to many interviews that she's given, this is to protect her privacy. She doesn't want anyone to know what she looks like so she can lead a normal life, absent of fame. And in a way, isn't that what the video for Chandelier is about as well? Dealing with an audience, with judgment? What it's like for a songwriter to pour your heart and soul into a song and have everyone listen to it? I'm gonna skip the brilliant Elastic Heart video and jump forward 2 years to the release of her concept album, This Is Acting. What ties these new songs together is that all of them were originally meant for someone else. Cheap Thrills was written for Rihanna, Alive started as an Adele song, and Move Your Body was pitched to Shakira. As to why she chose to release these tracks on her own, Sia simply said she didn't think the music would get heard otherwise. So why this is acting? Because she's jumping into a number of different characters on this record. In Cheap Thrills, she proclaims that she don't need dollar bills to have fun tonight. In Alive, she talks about crying into her pillow, and in Move Your Body, she's hot for you in every way. All very different characters and a challenge to bring together under one image. But it appears Sia has found a solution, and it all comes back to the bob. In the video for Alive, we see a new face under the wig, Mahiro Takano, and at iHeartRadio Music Festival, two men are seen wearing the bob. So what's the deal with that?
The concept of, you know, creating a brand which is an inanimate object, this blonde bob, you know, being able to put anyone under it, a kid, an adult, a man, a woman, a dog, you know, and then everyone can be the singer.
So basically, the idea behind the bob is everyone can be Sia, or there's a little Sia in all of us. Now you Sia, now you don't? Kind of. Sia is a songwriter first and foremost, which means she has to be able to jump into the minds of other artists. Almost like she puts on different wigs every day anyways. Most people like Sia because, quote, with her you get the feeling like it's really about the music. And it is, literally. The songs on This Is Acting weren't written for her. The only thing that ties these songs together is that they were written and performed by the same person. In the Ed Sheeran episode, I said an artist without an image is just a singer. Well, on this album, Sia is turning the fact that she doesn't have an image into an image. Now with Every Day is Christmas, this image is further diluted, to a point where a lot of non-hardcore fans who don't know about her background as a songwriter might start questioning Sia's authenticity. In a way, Sia is trying to be the Steven Spielberg of music. She doesn't act in her own work, she's directing from behind the scenes, and she doesn't do just one genre, she likes exploring all sorts of emotions. Unfortunately, the music industry has always been about identifying with one person or emotion. If we feel like someone is changing their character too much, they lose their authenticity and their music begins to sound fake to us. And this is the challenge with releasing Happy Christmas songs. It takes away from the last two albums. Unlike the movie industry, where the same actor can do horror, drama, and comedy, in music a piece of work never stands on its own. We always connect it to the performer. So far, the reviews for Sia's Christmas album have been lukewarm at best, and it's her lowest scoring album on Metacritic. If you're a fan of her more depressing titles, it's likely you're going to be disappointed. Now, does Sia care about that? Probably not. In fact, as we learned from an interview she gave on Howard Stern, she's not contractually obligated to promote any of her records, and she's made enough from writing for other pop artists to just write whatever the hell she wants. But there may be an important lesson hiding here. Setting a music career in motion actually has very little to do with sustaining it. And just because Sia can do it doesn't mean that you should. There's always more going on in the background. I meet a lot of songwriters and producers who want to do what Sia does. They want to explore and try out a lot of different things. They want to make it about the music and not themselves. They want to be Spielberg. And that is possible if you're writing for other artists. But if you want to be the center of attention, you better have a consistent story to tell, and you better start thinking about your image. If you enjoyed this video, please like, share, and subscribe. This has been Friedemann Findeisen from Holistic Songwriting, and I wish you all a Merry Christmas / Hanukkah / Goat Sacrifice, whatever floats your boat. See you next year for season 2. Until then, keep writing and stay gefährlich.